part two. So anyway, yeah, I don't know. I don't think this guy's going anywhere, I'll tell you the truth. So yeah, he's going to start arguing for free will or something, that we're doing something, some sort of accomplishment in this thing, like you're going to progress to something or go somewhere or do something, and there's nothing to do. There's nothing to be accomplished. That's why it's metaphored as a game. It's because it's basically just for entertainment value. And if you have a game for entertainment value that's way too expensive, you don't play it. This isn't a cure. This isn't something that's going to make the universe well or heal it or cure it. It's not going to do anything. The potential is just down potential. All you can do is minimize losses. And the easiest way to minimize the losses is don't turn the key.
We don't have supernatural free will, but we do have autonomy. Some limited degree of self-control.
Yeah, whatever that means, right? Self-control, what self would that be? The desire to do one thing over the desire to do another thing. I mean, it's just, and control how? What's going to make the decision in the end? It's not going to be any special forces. It's not going to be special knowledge. It's going to be what you've learned and what you understand, and that's going to be the only thing you have. It's the only weapon you have. And it's completely a deterministic weapon. So there's no freedom here.
And it's in large part our reason, our cerebral cortex, that gives us that control, that separates us from the rest of the influences in the external world.
Whatever. It doesn't separate us from the other animals, if that's what you're trying to say. Certainly doesn't separate us from any influences in the rest of the world. You have to be educated to acquire knowledge, to understand gameplay and all of that kind of thing. You can't play chess. Can't just sit there in front of a chessboard and know how to play it. Well, you can't play life right either until you know the dynamics and the mechanism, what's being traded here. And it's not that complicated, okay? It's just like chess, except make the little pawns capable of screaming as you push them off the board, and you'll get the idea. It's not that complicated. There's victims. There's things used up for the gameplay.
And it lets us do our own thing. That lets us not just follow the genetic routines, the animalistic, instincts.
Yeah, well, whatever. There's follow, follow, follow. Follow then what? What do you follow then? Then you're just back in the fix thing boat. You're just being a mechanic then. Yes, just fix the things that are broken. Fix the rescue, whatever you can rescue. Well, that's not much of a statement for creating a life form. I'm going to create a child so it can be a janitor. That would be idiotic. And so, yeah, if you take the desire out of the game, you take the game out of the game. There's no game without your silly, superficial, trivial, personal desires.
That allows us to think twice and not just react in a reflexive, knee-jerk way.
Now, even your brilliant ideas are going to be knee-jerk in a way. They're going to be logically dictated, okay? So they're going to have jerk all over them. You're not going to have a choice into seeing something, all right? If you see the car backing up, you see the kitten sitting in the driveway, you see the car heading for the kitten, it all adds up. You have to move. You have to act. You don't have a choice.
Based on the stimuli that we're faced with. So I'll sort of come back to this, but it looks to me like this kind of higher intelligence is already evidence that we can rebel against nature. And this is the alternative that I think we are left
with. Yeah, well, it's not just about rebelling against nature. It's rebelling against nature with something more logical, more sensible, more intelligent, more consistent knowledge-wise with the facts of the circumstance. If you're going to rebel against nature with something just as preposterous and stupid and chaotic and idiotic and moronic as nature, well, then you're not doing anything new. You're just doing something different. You're not doing anything better. Better word. You're not doing anything better. Better requires consistency to the facts.
As opposed to just antinatalism, committing genocide and terminating all life.
Well, genocide is the wrong word to use. Genocides are based on some sort of genetic differences, bigotries, that kind of crap, so that's kind of bullshit. This isn't about something bigotry against genetics, okay? It's a mere statement of fact explaining that this game we're playing, this evolution thing, has no place to go, but it just digs its own grave, and then it tries to climb out of it like some kind of zombie. And that's basically the metaphor. There's just no good that can come of it. All downside potential. And if you did it perfectly, you'd have accomplished nothing.
There's another alternative, which is to not play the animalistic game, but to play a different game.
Right. Play the, let's all dress up in little special robes and go woo woo woo, woo woo woo. You know, and hire the peasants to polish our gold statues or something. What other game is there? There's no other game, fella. If you don't have desire, you don't have a cause. You don't have a purpose, okay? This, you have to deal with the fact of what stimulates us. What's the word I've used to describe it? It's not attraction. It's not accomplishment. Agenda. Okay, the nature sets the agenda. It creates the necessity of pushing through the mush to get to something. It creates the perception of the Holy Grail in our eye, and then the necessity and the hunger and the need to go get it.
One that is defined by us. I'll come back to that. So the next point, the game metaphor. This is a tricky thing. I mean, His images are striking again, but they're also misleading in this particular case. This idea of evolution as a game is misleading, and he knows he would...
No, it isn't. Okay, again, there's no... What else do you describe a mechanism that has no function? All right, now, if life had a function, if I could sit there and apply it to it's a cleaner, it's a cleanser, then I could test it as its cleansing ability. How much did it cost, how much does it pollute, and how much does it clean? I could ask the logical questions, because there's an accomplishment here. There's something getting done, and I can make some sort of price equation. But obviously, life does not produce anything. It does not serve to heal the universe, correct a broken, fix something that's broken without our existence. The universe is not broken without the Martians. Nobody, I don't think, has ever written on a sign, until we have Martians, the universe is broken. No one's written that down a sign somewhere and put it in the ground and said that's the truth, have they? Have they said that about Venetians? Until we create Venetians, the universe is null and void. It's not good enough. It's broken. It's incomplete. It's insufficient because it doesn't have Venetians in it. Is that sign written somewhere? Has some human articulated that statement? No, they have not. Okay? Because it's bullshit. Just as the same sign written with earthling on it would mean exactly the same thing. It would be bullshit. Okay? We aren't a necessity. We're a frickin' entertainment. You're entertaining yourselves. Okay? You're jerking off and you're greasing your dick, okay, with sentient organisms. Alright? That's what you're doing. You're entertaining yourself at something else's expense, and that's bullshit. You're not accomplishing anything. You're cleaning up messes your ancestors made. Fuck all of you. And fuck the mess you keep making.
No, if he's an atheist, so he knows there's no, God or ultimate...
Right, so how exactly is God relevant to a game metaphor? Oh, that's right, a game metaphor would be completely opposite of a God, so I guess God is out of the argument, okay? So you're on the game metaphor. You're saying there's something wrong with the game metaphor, so God is sort of an irrelevant thing to mention.
Find ultimate person behind life on Earth. But of course, games are artifacts. They're things that are intelligently designed, that are designed by...
Well, let's not be silly. You think every game is intelligently designed? No, all a game needs is rules. That's all. If you have a set of rules and you have an end game, then you have a game, okay? And it's the same metaphor you could apply, like I said, if it was a machine, you would judge it based on how much gasoline it consumed versus how much good work it produced. And if it doesn't produce any good work, then it better be entertaining, right? If it's going to suck up gas, it better be playing one hell of a good movie, or it better be going somewhere. But if it's not doing one of those two things, you're going to say, why are you wasting gasoline on it? So, I mean, this playing with the legitimacy of metaphor is just idiotic, okay? We can call all kinds of things can be called a game. Game theory, have you heard of that? Come on. It all has to do with an order and a logic, a procedure of events, okay? A combination of a procedure of events, and all you're doing is explaining whether the events are justifiable in terms of they produce some sort of end that's worth it.
The programmers of the game, those who come up with the rules of the game. So natural laws are descriptive. They're not to be confused with prescriptive or...
Well, whatever. Who's saying they're being confused with prescriptive? To say that they are descriptive is idiotic. The fact is they are facts. They're facts. Okay? They're facts. Evolution's a fact. Okay? It's a fact that this molecule evolves through creating huge amounts of monstrosities, failures, that it smashes to bits. That's the truth of the game, okay? It's not a prescription, it's a description of the facts.
Social laws, of course, and neither they need to be confused with the types of rules that, you know, determine, that there are the social conventions that determine a game, that set up the limits of a game.
They have everything, they have every appearance of being just like every other kind of rule we would make for a synthetic game. A synthetic game would duplicate the natural game. You think my description of nature is somehow a bastardization of the word game? No, I'm sorry. You've got it backwards, okay? The word game is a bastardization of what we see in nature. Jeez. Okay, so what I'm describing is the origin of the game. It is the first game.
Whether it's chess or baseball or whatever, or the rules of the road. Games are artifacts. They are, so evolution, natural life is not a game in that respect.
Well, whatever. If you think this is some sort of a meaningful, this argument's going to be meaningful to me. I mean, maybe you can fool some idiot with this. Playing with the word game and pretending, well, because it's not technically a game, then therefore that argument's invalid and the game doesn't have to be entertaining and it doesn't have to produce a winner and it doesn't have to do it at a fair cost and it doesn't have to be judged for its efficiency and now it's exempt somehow from judgment. How does this gameplay with the word game change the facts, okay, that life is a system, okay, that the universe is a system, and it can be judged for its efficiency. Shit.
The laws of biology, they are regularities. They are defined by natural forces.
Who I need you to tell me that? No, I don't need you to tell me that. What it is, it's a confinement by rules. It's a separation of character, construction. Eccentricity, you could even call it, a separation of eccentricity, a filtering of eccentricity through a process. Yeah.
Not by rule, so that in the sense of prescriptive laws, social laws, regulations that are chosen by anyone. No one chooses how natural selection works. It just happens. It just emerges as a natural phenomenon. So the reason I bring this...
Well, it doesn't matter. But, you know, it doesn't. The whole universe is deterministic. You want to sit there and play games, you can't now call anything anything because everything's determined from the very beginning. Well, it still can be called a contest, or it still can be called a choice or a decision or all these kind of things. You can still use words like this without being totally out of bounds. Just for the sake of understanding the distinction between something that takes place in a small, narrow window of time and something that takes place in a bigger window of time. These are perfectly good qualifications. You're going to break all language now? You're going to pretend? I mean, it's just stupid.
So, is because, here's why it's misleading. I think that when we talk about evolutionary life as a game, we are want to commit the naturalistic fallacy here. Adding extra pressure to us to play this game because it's as if it's not.
What a crock of crap that is. That doesn't mean anything. The naturalistic fallacy that somehow now we're obligated to play the game. Where would that be? Have anything to do with any argument I've made? Well, obviously, it has nothing to do with any argument I've made. So that's just absolute crap. You know, look, the use of the metaphor is used for the simple purpose of describing the fact that there's winners and losers, that the outcome is not based on some kind of great standard of merit, that like a game, Okay, a game couldn't be playable without the ingredients of deserve, you know, some sort of decent standard of victory, and consent. You wouldn't be allowed to play a game for life and death without those two things. And here we are playing this life thing, game, thing, whatever you want to call it. We're playing the life thing without those two ingredients, and it's as fundamentally broken as it would be if it was a game. As if it was a game. There. That's for that limited use of the game metaphor, you're still going to play this stupid game?
Just that we do perform these natural roles, these animalistic roles of, you know, reproducing and consuming and so on, but it's that we ought to. That these are roles in a game, that the game is good. Because it's a game, you know, it's sort of good to play it. Somehow it's...
Nobody's going to get that. No one's going to be plagued by that misunderstanding in any of my uses of the metaphor. Are they ever going to be confused and think because Gary called it a game, he means that we should play it? So that is about as ludicrous and idiotic and unrelated and disconnected from anything I've ever said as something could possibly get. So way to make a wacky, stupid, irrelevant argument.
It's our function in the sense of it's our purpose. It's not just that we do perform these roles, but it's that we ought to. That would be fallacious. And of course,
and Mendham says exactly that. So you've just wasted 3 minutes of time talking absolute rubbish about something that's totally irrelevant to any conversation I have engaged in. So, bravo.
He wouldn't want to explicitly say this. He wouldn't say
it. He wouldn't say it implicitly. He wouldn't imply it. He wouldn't say it. He wouldn't go anywhere near it. He wouldn't touch it with a 5-million-foot rhinoceros horn.
Say this. But he's dangerously close to implying this. Just sort of slipping it.
Well, you're just about as far from the fucking truth as you could get. I'm not even anywhere close to implying it. I'm nowhere near saying it. I'm nowhere anywhere close to that. It's just a lie, fucker. What else can I say? It's a fucking lie. Show me one quote of mine where you could possibly imply that I was saying because it's a game, it's good. Show me one place where somebody could get that impression. Show me! Or else call yourself a liar and admit what you are, a liar.
In this kind of,
bullshit. This kind of bullshit. That's where you were, 2442. Thank you, YouTube.
It's our purpose. It's not just that we do perform these roles, but it's that we ought to. That would be fallacious. And of course, Mendham wouldn't want to explicitly say this. He wouldn't say this, but he's dangerously close to implying.
He hasn't said it. That's just a lie, liar.
This kind of misleading rhetoric in this case. There's no extra pressure to follow these evolutionary, you know, this animalistic way of life. It's something that we tend to do, that most animals do.
Yeah, that's right. So now he's implying, I'll just go by what he's implying, that what I do argue is that, yes, you do need a fundamental desire to play the game, that if you had a rat maze and the rats were fully fed, fat, and comfortable, and you put cheese way over there, okay, and they had to go through some slicing, dicing, risky thing to go get it, they'd say, fuck you, I'm going home. Take a nappy. All right? They wouldn't be bothered to play, idiot. All right? So, what I'm saying is, unless you create some sort of desire, some sort of mechanism of I need, I want, you don't have anything. You have nothing. So, live with that. Try to argue your way out of that. If you made a perfect world, then, you know, there was no harm in the world, there was no nothing, there would be very little incentive to get out of bed.
If it's possible that we can escape it, because maybe we evolve, we get this adaptation to control ourselves, just because that's the way the cookie crumbled in terms of, you know, the history of primates, then we can go out about our new business. We can just do something else. We cannot participate in that old game. And we cannot participate in that natural process, because that's what it is. It's not a game. If it's a game, then we might sort of feel, well...
Well, whatever. Process, game, whatever. Who cares? You want to call Monopoly process? You want to call the Olympics process? Go ahead and call it process, then. Let's destroy the word game, because you can't play with it reasonably and fairly. And we'll just call everything a process now. How's that? The lottery process, the... You know, we'll just throw the word game out and we'll just use the word process. And it's still going to come down to the same thing. There's processes that produce something and processes that produce nothing. And there's processes that are very expensive and processes that cost nothing. Unfortunately, life happens to be a process that produces nothing and does it at a very high expense. And that's why it's a loser in the process competition. It's a stupid process.
That's what we ought to be doing. It's as if God programmed it, because it's a game, so maybe we should think twice about playing a game.
Yeah, so now you see what he just did? God programmed because it's a game. So he just wants to play with the word game. Apparently game can't be used. Okay, so again, so we'll call it process. The process of evolution. That works, right? So let's just call it the process of evolution. We'll call football the processing of a game of football. Well, the processing of a contest of football. Okay, we'll call it all process. And that you're still going to be stuck with the fact that you have no way of distinguishing one process from the other process by any reasonable distinction. The metaphor fits, it is describable as such, and you're just weaseling out of your obligation to defend it.
Different game, or think twice about getting involved in some other enterprise. If it's a game, it's just, we might think...
Well, let's just use enterprise then. Process and enterprise, there. So now we fixed the language, have we? We took the word game out, and now we'll just use enterprise and process, and therefore we fixed the language.
But it's not a game, so there's no such extra pressure. It's just the natural forces make probable a certain way of life, at least for most species. So if it's not a game, you see, evolution, the natural laws...
Right, and the rules of football make certain process inevitable, like the football, you know, American football, it will make the process happen where they put on shoulder pads and big uniforms and helmets, and then they chase a little funny-shaped ball, and that will be what the process requires. So again, this is just such crap. Yeah, the fact is, evolution has rules, football has rules, the two things fit, the metaphors fit, you're just playing a weaselly game, damn it.
It can create all kinds of things in the world. It can create animals that are limited by certain laws, and they can also create higher forms of life. And that's, in fact, what has happened. So they've created people, for example, not just animals. They've created people in the form of our species. So we are not bound by that game.
Yeah, we're just like a football player, okay? They get taller, they get bigger, they get fatter, they get different things. They steroid up and turn into a new kind of machine. So, yeah, you could just analogize us to, yes, the new technology, okay? We got better helmets, you know, they got softer padding in them, they got different things, and that gives us an advantage. So, yes, we had a scheming mind, a scheming brain, and that's where we got it from. That's where the advantage came from. It made us capable of scheming. We could trick other animals into running off cliffs and doing all kinds of silly things, and that gave us advantage because we could manipulate. And that's it.
Yeah, I'll come back to that, but I just think we are not bound by that process. It's not a game, and that's the point I'm making. It's so misleading that I keep falling into is...
Yeah, whatever. Again, you're just going to play word games. Okay, I mean, this is just so demeaning to intelligence to sit there and say, you require me to use the word process instead of we'll use the word game. It's just silly. Silly.
Better there, but that... analogy is dangerous for the reason I tried to spell out there.
Yeah, there's nothing dangerous about it. Again, and I'm the one defending our intelligence, newsflash. Okay, I'm the one saying, yes, the only thing good about us, the only thing at all of any kind of redeeming value whatsoever is our capacity to be intelligent and to recognize the truth. But of course, if we're just going to lie and play word games to evade the truth, then fuck the intelligence. It doesn't mean anything because you're not using it. If you're using the intelligence to evade reality, then you're just a fucking... You might as well go back to being a weasel because you're basically a weasel.
Another point is in Mendham's what I call his consequentialism, his utilitarian argument. His point is that, one of his points is that the horrible natural process of life is not morally justified because there's no...
I never use the word morally. So again, that's just bullshit again. Another one of these impositions of some dogmatic sentiment that has nothing to do with utilitarianism. It's not about morality. Okay, it's about an ethical equation, and it's about a value equation. It's about value exchanges. You get your comfort at some Chinaman's discomfort. You whack off his arm so you can have an iPad. That kind of value exchange that takes place every day. And the value exchange we make with animals is obscenely brutal. And it's a theft, it's insensible and malicious.
No ultimate good. There's no victory at the end of the road that's going to be good enough to justify all the horrors of all the bloodshed and the torture and the suffering and the exploitation that's gone on for...
That's right. You can't... You're not going to come up with one single event in your whole stinking, lousy life that's going to be worth one day of imposing chemotherapy on an 8-year-old kid. You're just not. You're not going to do anything that spectacular. You're just not.
For millions of years of life on Earth, there's no end that's going to justify it. So we think in terms of consequences here. It's just an endless cycle of...
It's a process. It's an endless process, okay? And it's processing poorly. It's a bad process. It's creating more waste than... what's a double... That was a W word for something good. Than wealth. Yeah.
Blood, sweat, and tears.
I use the term more friction than function. Yeah, do something with that. More friction than function. Get it? More losses to waste and heat and bad than productive value.
I just want to point out that in Mendham is sort of fond of saying that. At least in the videos that I've seen of his, he's made hundreds and hundreds of videos. I've only seen a handful, but he seems to like to say, that he definitely protests when someone says that he's religious or being emotional. He really does not like that. He says that no, it's just reason.
Well, I'm just saying, just make the argument. Okay, are you making an argument here? Your argument substantially for this whole fucking blob of time has been some inane crap about word usage. So yeah, that's not much of an argument. Your argument is to explain why you have the right to play with somebody else's welfare in a manner where you can't get consent and you can't ensure fairness. So deserve will have nothing to do with it, and you will not do it consensually. And you're going to tell me why you have a right to do that. And I just want to hear your explanation of why you have a right to play that game. Why you have a right to initiate or perpetuate that process. Why must that process exist?
It's rationality that leads to antinatalism. It's logic. It's science. It's the facts on the ground, all around us, which inform us of the horrible truth, and... Antinatalism is just a...
Right, and again, let's recognize what the horrible truth is. The horrible truth is we are as unmissable as the Martians. We are as unmissable as the Venetians. So we will accomplish nothing, and we will torture Earthlings to do it. That's the definition of stupid.
The philosophical, the best position, it's a logical choice, a rational choice. Now, I just want to point out that in this case, if we're talking about what the ultimate end of life is going to be, whether or not it's going to justify all that's gone before, it's not reason that tells us whether or not there's going to be such a good, an ultimate good that's going to justify evolutionary life. That is speculation.
What a pile of nonsense. We don't even know the answer to the question, right? In the sense that, you know, we can only speculate from our perspective. But what evidence do we have? Yes, if you wish to claim there's going to be a magic purpose, well, go ahead, give me some outline of what it's going to look like. We are the cure to unicorn hoof disease, and there's a bunch of unicorns that have hoof disease, and because we exist, we are going to cure unicorn hoof disease, and therefore the universe will be happy and grateful. What's your speculation? What's your reason for anyone to believe there's something else in this game than the parts we've already seen? What are you going to make that out of except wishful thinking? And you're going to say there's not a difference between rational anticipation of what can be deduced to be within the realm of reasonable and the unreasonable speculation of some idiot who just stands up and says, magic? We're going to do magic eventually?
Not logic. No one knows how life will ultimately end. No one knows whether there's going to be some great thing that life will evolve into or become or whatever that will in fact justify all the projects.
Right. So you're just saying that the 4 billion years of evolution on life has taught you nothing. Every organism has been made basically as a mouth and an anus, a digestive system for consuming, okay, and reproducing and little else. And you're saying that, no, it's going to somehow break free of the paradigm from which the sea it originated in and the mechanism that it originated with. And you're going to come up with some other mechanism besides some contrived notion of, I see the Cheeto. The Cheeto has value to me. I will chase it. You're going to find something else. Well, you're not going to find anything else. There's no evidence of anything else. And so you're just inventing a god. You're inventing the god of the golden pot at the end of the rainbow. You're just saying it's there. Trust me. Trust me, it's there. I'll torture things for your dream of a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. And I'm supposed to say that's reasonable? No, that's not reasonable. You have to do a lot better than that, buddy.
And suffering. No one knows. It's speculation. One way or the other. For example, transhumanists say there's going to be a technological singularity, and maybe that's going to make us all godlike, and we'll be able to use technology to somehow undo all the prior suffering, or who knows. That too is...
Yeah, no, we do know, okay? Undo the prior suffering. I mean, get real. So, I mean, you're not going to tell me that's leprechaun gold? I mean, leprechaun gold has a more realistic chance of being consistent with reality, okay, then you going time traveling and undoing the past harms. I mean, get real.
Totally speculation, but
bullshit is what it is.
In a better position there.
Well, I'm sorry. I'm in a much better position. I have a whole lot of fossil evidence and a whole lot of ways of describing the last 500 million years that are going to be a lot closer to reality than your fable that you're going to go into the future and jump backwards and put band-aids on everything. Fuck you, you're not going to do that.
Now, he talks about extraterrestrials here. He says that's some evidence. We've not encountered any evidence of extraterrestrials, so that should humble us. That should really make us think that maybe...
Well, in an infinite universe that had an infinite beginning and an infinite end and all this other bullshit that people keep talking about, well, you'd think that somehow if something actually worked in the forever that this shit has been going on, that working thing would somehow have left a fingerprint somewhere and said, hey, I'm here, I'll take care of things, don't worry, okay, I'll fix it. It'd leave that sign somewhere. Somewhere it would post a sign in the universe. Don't worry, be happy. I got it under control. No, there's nothing under control. There's nothing, there's no sign. There's nobody fixed it. Nobody got there. So forever and ever 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 and ever, okay, nothing ever fixed it. Obviously.
If other life that evolves elsewhere, it just fades out. It doesn't make enough noise for us to, you know, it doesn't seem to live long enough to become something wonderful So, you know, to become a utopian society.
Yeah, well, I don't think it's that it didn't live long enough. I don't think it ever existed. So, yeah, because there's lots of one-time events in the history of life on Earth that are perfect storm events. And, yes, this is a bizarre aberration of material function, not common functionality. So, yeah, it wasn't just time that was against us. It's physics that are against us, and the chemistry. And there is no biology. Biology happened here. Didn't happen everywhere else.
Where there's no more suffering, and I use the technology to, you know, make themselves godlike. There's no evidence of that in other species, so therefore we should be doubtful about whether we are going to achieve that end. That's sort of an argument you can make here. But, again, that's speculation. We don't.
Well, I'm just saying it's logical speculation, right? There's a logical pigeonholing here somewhere where you're just narrowed by logic. And I'm just saying if you're going to say the universe is infinite, then you're trapped, okay? Because it did have an infinite past, and you know, in that whole infinite past, nothing fixed it, nothing got control of it, nothing grabbed it by its nuts and did what needed to get done. It just allowed it to happen all over again, and the seeds, the whole 4 billion years, the whole inefficiency and waste of the reconstruction through the slow evolutionary process. Just think about even just human history, just the last 10,000 years of human history. Think of all the wars and all the brutality and all the diseases and all the pestilence and all the horrors that have been endured by human beings just to get us to the point where we can talk about, you know, sodium hydroxide or something. You know, where we can have a conversation about what the realities of thermal, whatever you want to call that, that moves clouds around and creates thunder and does all this stuff. And we can do this because of what. But look at what was paid. Look at the road that was the blood on that road to gain the knowledge, the little bit of knowledge we have. Come on. You're telling me that something clever in the universe, something smarter than us, couldn't figure out that it wouldn't leave things vulnerable to that? That it wouldn't let the raping keep on happening? That it might want to do something to stop World War II and World War III?
No. Why, you know, we haven't encountered any evidence of extraterrestrials. Maybe there are none evolved. Maybe we're the only ones. Or maybe they, you know, download themselves into their computers and live in virtual realities, virtual heavens, and that's where we have encountered them, because they're not flying around in spaceships. They are sublime, as I think Ian Banks says in his.
Yeah. Well, whatever. Again, you can't do that one. So what are you going to do? You know, pre-program the humans in the virtual reality. You're in big trouble right there. Program them with how much pain and suffering. How much emotional angst to make their passion worth it. Precondition them to be addicts. Doesn't sound like an ethical thing to do.
You know, science fiction books. They go into the technological singularity, past the event horizon, as it were, to where technology makes them gods. So that's...
Whatever. I mean, that doesn't even make any sense. Makes them gods in which way? In what way? Now, how are they gods? And how they have control? How they have anything? Again, the problem with gods is gods have no freedom either, theoretically. Where does God's inspiration come? Tweety Bird whisper in his ear? Who mooses God? Who inspires the God to one day sit around forever and then one day say, I'll make some shit? Yeah.
I mean, that's what happened to them. So, and again, it's just a point of speculation. No one knows.
We do know. So I'm sorry, we do. Right? We can logically deduce answers to these questions. You're just playing a game. Like, I'm saying we can't figure out what the real game is because of a piece of biology in a swamp replicated. Therefore, we can't draw any conclusions about how it functions. We don't know anything. It's all an unwritten book. No, there's a lot of writing in the book. The book dictates kind of the function, the mechanism, the dynamic of it. So don't keep pretending we don't know anything and that all speculation is equal. All speculation is not equal. Pots of gold at the end of the rainbow is not the same as speculating that Oh, you know what? If we throw a bunch of carbon into the atmosphere, it might fuck it up and create greenhouse problems. It might burn us to a cinder. Yeah, those two speculations are entirely different. We can qualify them and understand one of them to be bullshit and one of them to be, damn it, you better pay attention to that.
All right. On to the point about the equation. At one point here, the equation of the ratio between pain and pleasure. I'm not sure here how relevant the quantity, you know, the measuring of suffering, the quantifying of suffering is here. Because when we're quantifying suffering, when we're sort of tallying up all the pain that's gone on versus the relatively small amount of pleasure, we're sort of objectifying mental states. And that...
Duh. Yeah, we're sitting there saying, what is this mental state and what is it worth? The same way we would do that if we were, if you were conducting a laboratory experiment, then we're going to engage some rats in some sort of experiment that might have present jeopardy to their welfare. You would be able to sit there and decide whether it was worth it or not, wouldn't you? You'd be able to figure out, well, gee, if we can minimize how many legs get cut off and, you know, whether their tongues get cut off and, you know, you would be able to figure that out, wouldn't you? The good thing that was happening and the bad things that were happening and be able to make some kind of judgment about, gee, we should pay a little bit of attention to their welfare. You'd be able to do that, wouldn't you? Yeah, I think you would. It's only because it's humans, right? When it's talking about humans, then it matters. But everything else, fuck them, right? So if it's not you, is that what it is? It's about you. It's about your narrative, about your fantasies. Can't look at the game any other way than through your eyes.
In case we can no longer value them. I mean, when we're thinking in terms of quantities, when we're thinking in terms of how much pleasure versus pain we feel or some animals feel, we're no longer in a position to really think of them in moral terms as having value. We're just sort of tallying it up. And I just don't think that's really relevant.
Right. So if somebody made the argument in slave times that, hey, the slaves are suffering, they're human, we're not really making a profit. You know, we're having a good time. It's true. We're comfortable. We have nice soft pillows to sit on and all that kind of shit. So yeah, we're doing okay on their labor. But the fact is their labor matters. Their harm matters. And if we actually had to experience their harm, if we had to experience the suffering of being whipped in the field, we'd recognize it's not worth it. It's not worth the comfy pillow to be whipped in the field and to be raped and, you know, watch my sister getting raped. That wouldn't be worth it. I wouldn't want all this wine and bread and cheese and comfy life if I knew the price was to watching my sister get raped. Is that too complicated for you?
I mean, there's a Jewish proverb, at least according to Schindler's List. It probably comes from the movie Schindler's List. I think might come from the Talmud.
Yeah, well, I'm probably not going to have much fucking use for any Jewish proverbs, but go for it, fuckhead.
Or, you know, the Hebrew Bible.
Yeah, the same Bible that says, yeah, poke out their eyes until everybody's blind. Yeah, they're really bright. They're really smart, those revenge seekers.
But I think it goes something like, you know, if you save one person, you save the world. Or you save the whole species.
Yeah, well, that doesn't sound very logical to me. Sounds like a big pile of fucking goddamn leprechaun gold again.
The idea that, you know, every, any of these higher mental states has infinite value.
Whatever. So I'm supposed to make something out of that. I mean, really, what do you want me to do with that? Any higher mental state has infinite value. So when human beings 50,000 years ago didn't have these intellectual conversations, didn't even have the word game or process or intuition or any of those bullshit words, had no conception of those words, they weren't infinitely valuable because they were just stupid. Like, okay, they had a few words like ug and smug and bug and blug. But they didn't have enough of our sophisticated words, so therefore you could go ahead and cut their nuts off and it doesn't matter. Is that your theory? Go ahead and rape them. Doesn't matter. They're not infinitely important. Is that your theory? Well, it sucks.
Because it transcends the non-living part of the universe. It transcends the, you know, insect life and, or other natural processes that don't have this sort of wondrous...
So says the arrogant, pompous, self-glorifying, egomaniacal fucking human. Again, so we're just back to the Martian argument, right? The only reason why Martians could possibly be necessary is if you created a Martian who needs them to exist, right? You have to make the Martian before Martians can be necessary. You have to make a Venetian before the Venetians can be necessary. They have no value or utility or meaning until you create some little scuzzy bastard member of their race or their group or their gang who says, no, the reds are great. We need more reds or the blues or the greens or whatever the fuck you are. You're just a fucking member of some stupid clan who just says the jackass clan has to exist because I'm a jackass and I want it. And you're telling me that's going to be an argument that's going to somehow beat my logical arguments and value equations. No. No chance, buddy.
You know, fact of these higher, these mental states, whether it's pleasure or pain, any of them, if we're talking about the higher, most complex kind, each of them has sort of infinite value. So it's crass to just, you know,
whatever, it's just stupid. If each of them has infinite value, then I can just do the fucking infinite math then, right? Double affinity. Well, I got triple affinity over here that you're torturing, and you only have one affinity over there, so you're still two affinities behind. I mean, it's just stupid.
In terms of an equation, of a ratio, it's crass to quantify it. As if we...
Right. So if there was five infinite universes, we couldn't acknowledge them as five distinct universes of infinite expandability, because even though they were distinct, they were each individually infinite universes, we couldn't acknowledge it because the rule of infinity says you can't acknowledge something's individuality. That isn't going to work.
Could add it up in the first place, and this is another thing. Again, it's speculation. No one knows which outweighs the other, whether it's pleasure or pain. No one knows.
Right. So, again, you're just going back to the same dodge, all right? This no one knows stuff. We've all experienced conscious experiences. We've all experienced biases that are built into us. We've all been seduced by something. We've all thought something is necessary to our existence, and then we get it, and we realize, oh, shit, I just wanted that really bad, but I don't really need it. You haven't run into that little brick wall where you wanted something, and then you got something, and then you said, man, I really don't need this thing that I got? That's sort of the mechanism of the game. It's a desire game. It really isn't a getting game. It's the chase. We are the hamster in the wheel. It's really not about getting somewhere, it's just about wanting to go somewhere.
Well, whether it's been more, just no one knows, it's speculation, no, there's no algorithm that's going to arrive, it's going to allow us to calculate that ratio.
Well, it's, the algorithm isn't that complicated, but you could certainly calculate whether or not you're going to subject something to risk. I mean, you can do these calculations. If there's a 1 in 10 chance that because of some failure in your car, and you know it statistically, that there's a 1 in 10 chance that some 8-year-old will get run over, you can be smart enough to say, well, that's not worth it, because all I was going to go to the store to get was bread and ego gratification, and somebody was going to say I looked really cool in my new glasses. You'd say, yeah, no, that shit isn't really worth running over a kid. So you'd be able to make these equations and these statements. So to pretend that it's beyond our scope or capacity to recognize what imposition is, to recognize what risk is, and to recognize when we have a right to impose risk on somebody else, when we have a right to gamble with their property, we can figure these things out.
Even if it were relevant in the first place, I don't think it is relevant what I just said about the infinite value of any of these mental states, because all of them transcend, in fact, they transcend what he calls the game, what ultra pessimism would think of in that way.
So whatever, he's saying his ego desire to climb a mountain or something transcends all victimhood. So if I want to create a double nuclear plant or something, yeah, I'm allowed to do it because I want it. It transcends your rights. If I irradiate all you fuckers, so what? I want it. It's infinite. My want has infinite value. No, it doesn't.
Any of our pleasures or pain has infinite transcendent value. So that means that one of these pleasures...
Right, because that's based on some Jewish proverb. So you're going to make accusations about me being pseudo-religious when you're going to sit there and quote proverbs and then tell me I have to account for it as the truth, that the proverb says so. Okay, any human ambition has infinite value. I don't think so.
In the world, one person listening to Mozart, for example, to take a kind of pretentious example, but...